Hello friends, good afternoon and welcome to your DSET live lectures. Dear friends, as you know that we have started a series on organic chemistry and today we are conducting yet another lecture in the same series. In today's lecture we will be talking about alkanes part 2 and aromaticity. To discuss this topic we have with us our subject expert Dr. Leena Khanna. Dr. Khanna is assistant professor in University School of Basic and Applied Sciences, Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, New Delhi. Without further ado, I would like to welcome ma'am to our studios and request her to start the lecture. Welcome ma'am.
Thank you. Hello viewers, you must be remembering in the last lecture we have started alkanes and we have discussed the physical property of alkane and the preparation of alkane. Now today lecture is dedicated to the chemical properties of alkane, and I have told you in the last class that in the last lecture that CH bond is highly strong bond, it's a covalent bond, it has no electron withdrawing group present on carbon CH bond. You can see on the Pauling scale the electron difference between carbon and oxygen is only 0.35. So this bond is highly strong, it is non-polar and cannot be broken so easily. And these kind of compound, they are inert compound and they are also known as paraffin, that is Fever reactive compound. And the bond energy you can see here, it is very high. CH bond energy is 104 kilocalories per mole. And it's very difficult to perform reaction on alkanes, but these compounds can undergo certain substitution reaction, means we can replace the hydrogen by certain groups like halogens, nitro group or sulfonic acid group under vigorous condition. So these substitution reaction can be discussed. So the first reaction we can discuss is the halogenation, which is a very important reaction of alkane. This halogenation reaction, it is carried out under the condition of UV light or in the presence of very high heat or high temperatures. This reaction is a free radical reaction. There is a generation of free radicals, and all the free radical reaction, they are divided into three steps. The first step is always the initiation step in which the radicals are generated. The radicals are generated by the homolytic cleavage of bond. Now here we have two reactants. One an alkane and then there is halogen. Halogen we can take generally chlorine and bromine, and we can break this bond homolytically. Chlorine-chlorine bond or bromine-bromine bond can be broken homolytically either in the presence of light or heat, and that homolytic cleavage is the first step of the free radical reaction. And the second step of free radical reaction is propagation, in which the free radical which is generated reacted with another reactant, that is the alkane, and generate the products. And the product is generally a substitution product, that is the formation of an alkyl halide. So that step generally, it's a rate determining step of the reaction. It is also known as a propagation step. Finally, a free radical reaction has to undergo termination. In that step, the free radicals, all the free radicals present in the reaction mixture, the left behind free radical, they have to have combined themselves and form neutral molecules. So first you can. We can show this in the form of chemical equation also. You can see here this XX is a chlorine-chlorine or a bromine-bromine bond. This bond is made up of two electrons. So when we break this bond, each atom will be getting single electron by a homolytic cleavage. So this is the first step of the reaction. Second step, I have told you, that is a propagation. So once a halide radical is formed, it has to react with an alkane. Suppose we are taking here methane. The simplest alkane is methane. So this halide radical is reacting with methane in the next step, and it is abstracting the hydrogen radical and forming hydrogen halide and methyl radical. This methyl radical now reacts with the second molecule of halogen and cleaves this bond homolytically and forms the product, that is methyl halide and X radical. This X radical now again propagates to react with the other molecules of methane and forms the methyl radical, and this reaction will go on and on till we are getting a large amount of methyl halide. And then in the end, the termination has to be taking place. All the free radicals which are present, leftover free radicals, they have to combine with themselves or with the other moiety present in the molecule and forms the neutral molecules. Then the overall reaction we are getting here is methane reacts with halogen and forming methyl halide. Now, this reaction is not so simple. It is not forming only the methyl halide as the product. It is giving a mixture of products. And these mixture of product can be a simple methyl halide, as we have discussed. It can be dihalomethane, means two halogen atoms has been added. It can be a trihalomethane, that is addition of three halogen atom, and it can be a tetrahalomethane. If it is a chlorine compound, then it is forming chloroform, carbon tetrachloride, dichloromethane and methyl chloride as a mixture of product. So this reaction is not a very good reaction because it is ending up in a mixture of product. And why it is giving a mixture of product? The reason behind this is the mechanism of the reaction. You can see in the propagation step, I have told you that the halide radical is formed first in the initiation step, then it is reacting with methane and forming the methyl halide. Now the methyl halide, once it is formed, the concentration of methyl halide is progressively increasing. As the concentration increasing, the probability of this halide radical to react with methyl halide or either with methane also increases. It can react with methane or it can react with methyl halide, because both the moiety, they are containing the hydrogen atom, and these replaceable hydrogen can be attacked by the halide radical. So when this methyl halide act as a reactant for halide radical, we are getting this radical, that is a methylene chloride radical. This methylene chloride radical again reacts with the next molecule of halogen and form methylene chloride or dichloromethane. And this dichloromethane or dihalomethane has two more replaceable hydrogens. So this can again can be attacked by the halide radical and form then trihalomethane. Then trihalomethane contains one more hydrogen that can be replaced. So trihalomethane can further react with X radical and form trihalomethyl radical. This trihalomethyl radical reacts with next molecule of the halogen and forms the tetrahalomethane or carbon tetrachloride in the case of chlorine. So this reaction has a drawback, it is giving a mixture of product. But still this reaction is an important reaction of alkane, and we are going to start starting the mechanism of the halogenation in the case of methane. The mechanism of halogenation in case of chlorination and bromination is almost similar, but the overall reaction, rate of reaction for chlorination and bromination differ. And why this is differ, we are going to discuss in the mechanism of the halogenation. The first step of the halogenation reaction I have told you, that is the breaking of XX bond, and it is taking place in the presence of heat and light. And the next step is the breaking of bond, we always require energy. So first step is an endothermic reaction. You can see here the homolytic cleavage of chlorine-chlorine bond requires about 58 kilocalories per mole of energy, and this energy is supplied by either using UV light or either heating the reaction. So this reaction, the first step of the reaction is an endothermic reaction. It requires energy to be given. So chlorine radical, once formed, they are highly reactive. They collide with the molecules of methane and try to form the product. So the second step of the reaction is the collision of chlorine molecule with the methane, and this collision should be such that it is giving a productive reaction, that is, it should form a product. And step 2 is the abstraction of hydrogen to form the product. So when this reaction is taking place, it requires a little amount of energy, which is plus 1 kilocalories. It is slightly endothermic, but it requires certain amount of activation energy or energy which we will be discussing later on. And the step 3 is the reaction of methyl radical with the another radical of halogen, that is an exothermic reaction. So it is giving out energy. So overall reaction with chlorine is productive and exothermic. You can see step 3, it is releasing minus 25 kilocalories per mole of energy. So once the reaction is taking place, it is exothermic and a productive reaction. But the reaction overall is exothermic, but it requires higher temperature, because the first step of the reaction is requiring a high temperature, and it is an endothermic reaction, that is the cleavage of the halogen-halogen bond or chlorine-chlorine bond. So that is why the overall reaction requires the higher temperature. Now the main step, which is giving the mechanism of the reaction, is step 2, and the progress of this step 2 can be discussed on the basis of energy of activation. Now, what is an energy of activation? Energy of activation can be described by using a potential energy diagram. When the molecules they collide, coming closer to collide, they have some kinetic energy, and when they are coming closer, their kinetic energy is converted into potential energy, and reaction begins, and it start, and the potential energy of the whole system increases. When it reaches the top of the hill, the molecule has got the sufficient potential energy to undergo reaction, and that energy hill of the potential energy diagram is known as the activation energy for the reaction to occur. When it reaches that hill or at the top of the hill, then the reaction start, and then after that the product is forming, and once the product is formed, the molecules they are losing potential energy, and they are going to the downside of the next potential energy diagram, and during the fall the potential energy converted back to the kinetic energy of the product. So in this case, in this whole procedure, the products are formed at higher potential energy side. That means there is a decrease in kinetic energy, and heat is taken from the surrounding, and there is a decrease in the temperature of the surrounding. And this step 2 you can of the reaction can be seen in the case of chlorine. You can see that this chlorine radical is reacting with methane. So when chlorine radical is colliding with methane moiety, the kinetic energy of the system decreases and potential energy starts increasing, and then at the topmost point the reactions start occurring. That means the bond breaking of CH3H bond starts, and bond making of HCl bonds is also going to be start. So at this point the maximum potential energy of the system reaches, and this energy is required by the system to reach this point. Once this energy is achieved by the system, then only the products are forming. So at this point the system has got 4 kilocalories per mole of energy, then the products are formed, the reaction is taking place, then there is a decrease in the potential energy, and finally the CH3 radical and HCl is formed. So you can see the step 2 as a potential energy diagram we have seen. So step 2 is the attack of chlorine radical on methane, which requires the collision between the molecule, and there is a formation of HCl bond, and there is a breaking of CH3H bond, and bond making and bond breaking, it should occur simultaneously, but this is not the case. Generally the bond making and bond breaking, they are occurring at a different rate, and when the HCl bond is forming, it is giving 103 kilocalories per mole of energy, but the breaking of CH3H bond requires 104 kilocalories per mole of energy. So you can see the difference is only of 1 kilocalorie per mole, but the bond formation and bond breaking is not occurring simultaneously with the same rate. So that is why the overall reaction is requiring not 1 kilocalories per mole of energy, but it is requiring 4 kilocalories per mole of energy in order to undergo the step 2 of the reaction. And it is following this diagram, and it is giving out the product after absorbing 4 kilocalories per mole of energy. So source of activation energy is the kinetic energy of the molecule, and also the proper this energy should be given by us, and there is a proper orientation of particle is very important. Methane should gives its proper orientation. That means the hydrogen should collide with chlorine. The orientation of methane should be such that the hydrogen should collide with chlorine, then only the chlorine radical will able to abstract the hydrogen atom of methane moiety and forming the methyl radical and HCl. So step 2 is very important, that it is requiring not only the activation energy or energy to reach the to cross the energy barrier, and it is also forming a reactive hydrogen, reactive methyl radical. So this is the case in the case of this is the mechanism in the case of chlorination. Similarly, in the case of bromination, the CH3H bond is breaking and HBr bond is forming. And in the case of HCl, it was when HCl bond is forming, the 103 kilocalories per mole of energy was giving out. But when HBr bond is forming, only 88 kilocalories per mole of energy is given out, and CH3H bond is breaking and it requires 104 kilocalories per mole of energy. So overall reaction you can see require 18 kilocalories per mole of energy, although the difference is between these two energies only 16 kilocalories, but the overall activation energy, because bond breaking and bond making is not occurring with a similar rate, so activation energy is, which is requiring is 18 kilocalories per mole. So in comparison to chlorine, bromine require high activation energy, and you can see this energy gap. When this reactant is reaching the top of the hill, there is a large energy gap in the case of bromine, which is very small in the case of chlorine radical, and it is forming product. So that is why the chlorine reacts more faster with methane in comparison to bromine, that we have discussed. But this rate of reaction between chlorine and bromine not only depend on the energy factor, it also depend on certain other factor, that is the collision frequency, energy factor that we have already discussed, that is activation energy, and the probability factor. And if any of the factor is differ, then the reactant may differ in the rate of reaction. So relative reactivity of bromine and chlorine can be compared only by the step 2 of the reaction, because step 1 of the reaction always require energy, that is the breaking of chlorine-chlorine or bromine-bromine bond. But step 2, that is the key step, that the activation energy is required for forming the methyl radical. In the case of chlorine, we have discussed that it is 4 kilocalories, in the bromine it is 18 kilocalories. That is why the reaction is slow in the case of bromine and fast in the case of chlorine. Although the size of bromine is very high, but its velocity, because of bulkier size, is again slow. So the collision frequency of bromine is also slow, but doesn't affect much because its size is large. So the overall effect of chlorine and bromine is similar. And probability factor means in the case of methane, the methane gives 1 out of 8 orientation, which gives out the productive reaction. So it is also similar in both the cases. The only difference in between chlorine and bromine is the activation energy. Activation energy in the case of chlorine we have discussed, that is 4 kilocalories, and bromine is 18. So that is why there is a energy gap between chlorine and bromine, that is this much of energy, this is much of energy gap, the chlorine becomes this much times more reactive than bromine. Now we can discuss the activity order of other halogens also, and I have told you that this reaction is divided into 3 steps. First step is the breaking of bond. If you consider this fluorine-fluorine bond require a little less amount of energy in comparison to chlorine. So it requires only 38 kilocalories of energy, chlorine-fluorine 58, bromine-bromine is again slightly weak bond in comparison to chlorine, it is 46. But we have discussed that bromine is requiring more activation energy in the step 2. So in the case of fluorine, chlorine and bromine, fluorine has got the least bond dissociation energy. So in the case of fluorine, reaction may occur in the dark also, it doesn't require any heating. So reaction is very vigorous, and that is why we are not using fluorine for halogenation of alkanes. But reaction with chlorine and bromine, we have already discussed. Reaction with iodine is again a very endothermic reaction, because once HI is formed, HI is unstable and the reaction is in equilibrium, it is not moving the forward direction, and we require certain oxidizing agent which will move the reaction in the forward direction. So iodination of halkane is also not very important. Then step 3 of the reaction is the combination of all the free radicals, and it is generally an exothermic reaction. So overall reaction is highly exothermic for fluorine, and while for iodine it is endothermic. And we have also discussed that the case of chlorine and bromine. So bromine is more reactive than chlorine, we have discussed in the case of methane. But certain other alkanes, we should discuss the halogenation of the other alkane also, like other alkane like propane. Propane can also undergo chlorination and bromination, but the chlorination and bromination both lead to the mixture product, and the related amount of the two product depends upon the nature of chlorine and bromine. And chlorine gives, if you consider the chlorination of propane, chlorination gives the 1 chloropropane in 45% yield and 2 chloropropane propane in 55% yield. While if you perform the bromination, you can see the temperature difference also. The bromination require high temperature, and bromination gives one bromo product in only 3% yield, while the two bromo product in almost 97% yield. This shows that bromine is more selective in its reaction. Bromine is more selective and less reactive. This is the common statement always given for an halogenation reaction. Why we are giving this statement? This statement now in this case depends on in the case of other alkanes not from methane, this selectivity and reactivity of bromine can be discussed by the following reason. The first reason, there are three main reasons behind this. The first reason is the types of hydrogen atom available for abstraction. In the case of methane, there are only one kind of hydrogen atom, that is primary hydrogen atom. But in the case of propane, you can see here, propane has two ends. It has two ends, and in the terminal carbon atom, these terminal carbon atom, they are linked only to single carbon, that is why they are known as primary carbon. And the primary carbon, they have primary hydrogen attached to the primary carbon, are known as primary hydrogen. But in the middle, it has carbon which is a secondary carbon attached to two more carbon. So this is a secondary hydrogen. So now if you count the number of primary hydrogen in the propane, there are 6, and number of secondary hydrogens, there are 2. So if we are focusing mainly on the step 2 of the reaction, which we have discussed previously also, that in the case of methane, this is a key step or the rate determining step of the reaction. So when a propane is reacting with an halide radical, then the abstraction of proton is abstraction of hydrogen atom is taking place. If a primary hydrogen is abstracted, then we are getting a normal propyl halide, and if a secondary hydrogen is abstracted, you can see here, we are getting a secondary propyl halide. So depending upon the hydrogen atom which is abstracted, we are getting different products. But you can see the number of primary hydrogens are more than secondary hydrogen. So you should get more amount of primary product, but this is not true here. We are getting lesser amount of the primary product. So this is something, there are something other reason which are operating here. So next reason you can see here is the ease of abstraction. Now what is an ease of abstraction? Ease of abstraction is the tendency by which a secondary hydrogen atom is abstracted or a primary hydrogen is abstracted. So when a secondary is abstracted, we are getting a secondary propyl radical. When primary hydrogen is abstracted, we are getting a primary propyl radical. And it was found that the number of secondary hydrogen, although they are less, but their productive collision frequency with chlorine radical is very high. That means when chlorine radical is abstracting a secondary hydrogen, the most of the collision they are leading to the product, because not all the collisions they are leading to the product, only certain collisions which are overpowering or which are overcoming the activation energy, they are forming the product. So secondary hydrogen has more tendency to get abstracted by the chlorine radical. So in the case of the chlorine, the ease of abstraction is given or studied, and it was found that the ease of abstraction in the case of chlorine radical, when a tertiary hydrogen atom is abstracted, it is 5, when it is secondary, the ratio is 3.8, and when primary hydrogen is abstracted, the rate of abstraction, relative rate of abstraction of hydrogen is only 1. So 5 is to 3.8 is to 1. This is the relative rate of abstraction of hydrogen atom present in the molecule. Although in the case of propane, there are only 2 kinds of hydrogen atom, but in certain other alkanes, it may be a tertiary hydrogen which is present in the molecule. So we can use this relative rate of abstraction for finding out the percentage of the two products formed. While in the case of bromine, again the relative rate of abstraction was studied, and it was found that bromine is highly selective. It is abstracting a tertiary hydrogen atom with an ease of 1600 versus the secondary hydrogen atom, it is 82, and with primary hydrogen atom, it is only 1. So this difference is very large in the case of bromine in comparison to chlorine. So using this ease of abstraction, we can find out the percentage of the product which can be formed during the halogenation of alkanes. So I have told you that when propane is reacting, it is forming 45 and 55% of the two product. But we can also calculate this percentage if ease of abstraction is given to us. So in the case of propane, first you will identify the number of hydrogen atom, the kind of hydrogen atom present. As I have told you, there are two kinds of hydrogen atom present. This is secondary hydrogen atom, this is primary. So there is a formula given, and there secondary hydrogen is abstracted, we are getting secondary propyl halide. When primary hydrogen is abstracted, we are getting primary chloride chlorine, 1 chloro propane. So you can find out the percentage of the two product by using this formula. We put first the ratio of the two product form, normal propyl chloride versus secondary propyl chloride, then it is equated with number of primary hydrogen atom with the number of secondary hydrogen atom, multiply by the reactivity of primary hydrogen atom and the reactivity of secondary hydrogen atom. Reactivity means the ease of abstraction, and ease of abstraction, I have told you, it is given to us in the question. So it is in this case the ease of reactivity of secondary hydrogen is 3.8 and reactivity of primary hydrogen is 1. So number of hydrogen atom, they are 6 and 2, so you can equate this. Then finally you are getting this ratio. When you equate this ratio with respect to 100%, we are getting 44 and 56%. So I have told you that in the previous case it was written 45 and 55, so almost equal to that percentage. So by using this calculation we can find out the percentage of the product form. Similarly, in the case of bromination you can also do the similar kind of calculation. In the case of bromination, only difference is of the ease of abstraction. Now I have taken this isobutane. In the molecule you have to look for the kinds of hydrogen atom present. So there are 3 terminal methyls. So these terminal methyls have got only primary hydrogen. So 9 primary hydrogens are there, and this carbon, you can see this is a tertiary carbon, and this tertiary carbon is attached to 3 methyl group, the carbon atom. That is why it is a tertiary carbon. Hydrogen of this tertiary carbon is tertiary hydrogen. So we have to look in the ease of abstraction of tertiary hydrogen. So we are getting 2 kinds of product, one by the abstraction of primary hydrogen atom, one by the abstraction of tertiary hydrogen atom. And we can find out the percentage by equating in the equation, this equation, number of primary hydrogen 9, number of tertiary only 1, and reactivity order is 1 by 1600. So finally we will be getting this 9 by 1600. So less than 1% of the normal isobutyl bromide is forming, and almost we are getting 100% of tertiary butyl bromide. So this equation can be used any kind of alkane for chlorination and bromination. So this is the second part or second reason for the reactivity of bromine over chlorine. Bromine is more selective than chlorine. First reason was the number of hydrogen atom we have to predict, and the ease of abstraction. Ease of abstraction in the case of bromine, it is selectively abstracting the tertiary hydrogen atom. The third point, third reason for the formation of the secondary product in the case of bromine is stability of free radical. Now free radicals, in the previous lecture we have discussed that tertiary free radical is very stable in comparison to secondary or primary radical. And stability factors we have discussed already, and this stability factor is also important here, because when this halide radical is abstracting the hydrogen, we are getting 2 types of product. One is primary radical and another is secondary radical. And secondary radical, we have seen in the previous lecture, it is more stable than primary radical. And ease of abstraction, we have also discussed that ease of abstraction of proton is tertiary is more than secondary than primary. So also if ease of abstraction is this, that means the ease of formation of radical is also this. Tertiary radical is forming with more faster in comparison to secondary and primary. So more stable the free radical, more easily it is formed, and less amount of activation energy is required. But when you see, when you look at chlorine radical, this should be obeyed in the case of chlorine and bromine radical, both in the case of chlorine and bromine radical. But when this chlorine radical attacks this propane moiety, this chlorine radical try to abstract either the primary hydrogen atom or the secondary hydrogen atom. But this chlorine radical is very reactive. It goes to the hydrogen very fast, and in that case the hydrogen chlorine bond is start forming, and this carbon is not getting much radical character. This CH bond is not broken so much, but this hydrogen chlorine bond is forming more faster in comparison to formation of this CH bond, and that is why the transition state, if you look at the transition state, there is a little loss of the delta character or the radical character of this chlorine, and this carbon is getting a very little of radical character. So the properties of the radical, that is secondary radical is more stable than primary radical, is not much affecting the stability of transition state, because in the transition state carbon is not getting a sufficient amount of delta radical character. Similarly here, if it is abstracting this primary hydrogen atom, the radical character is coming on the primary carbon, and this carbon is getting a very little radical character because this HCl bond is forming faster in comparison to the breaking of this CH2H bond. So this incipient radical which is forming in the transition state is not getting much of the stability factor affecting its formation, and both the transition state they are in equal percentage, and both the product which are forming after this transition state, they are almost in equal amount, that is 45% and 55%. But in the case of bromine, the bromine radical is very unreactive. It cannot able to react with H so easily. That is why it is giving this CH bond is breaking more faster in comparison to the formation of this HBr bond. Bromine radical is reacting slowly with this H, and this CH-H bond is forming breaking faster. That is why this carbon is getting more amount of radical character, and when this carbon is getting a radical character, the stability difference between this secondary propyl radical and primary propyl radical becomes effective, and the stability factor which is stabilizing this secondary radical is also stabilizing this transition state. So this transition state is becoming more stable than the transition state which is below. So this is in higher percentage, the above one is forming in higher percentage, so we are getting the product as the more percentage of the secondary propyl bromide. So bromination is giving less reactivity and the more selectivity, that is why we are getting 2-chloro-bromopropane in higher amount. So this is about the halogenation reactions of alkane. Now next is the isomerization reactions of alkane. Alkane can also undergo isomerization. Isomerization is sometimes useful because isooctane is more stable than isooctane is used as an anti-knocking agent in the fuel. So sometimes this the formation of the isomerized alkane is become useful. So isomerization of alkane can be done by using the normal hexane. This normal you can see this isomerization can be done using AlCl3. Normal hexane is a substrate using anhydrous AlCl3, and we also require catalytic amount of water and an alkene. So when a catalytic amount of water reacts with anhydrous AlCl3, there is a formation of a proton, and this generation of a proton, this proton reacts with initiator like an alkene used as an initiator and forms a carbocation. So this carbocation attacks the hexane moiety, and this hexane has got 3 carbons. If it reacts with alkene, we are getting 2 types of carbocation, positive charge at C2 and positive charge at C3. But there is another carbon here, it is C3 from this side, so it also getting a positive charge. So in all we are getting a transition state in which hydrogen proton is moving between these 3 carbon atoms. Then finally a methyl group migrates, terminal methyl group migrate from this carbon to any of the 2 other carbon atom and forming 2 methyl pentane and 3 methyl pentane as the major product. Similarly, we can do the nitration. Nitration can occur at very high temperatures of 400 degrees centigrade, and it is forming the multiple product because during the nitration we are using a very high temperature, so molecule can undergo bond breaking also. So if you can see here, normal butane on nitration gives not only the nitrobutane, but it is also giving the 1 nitrobutane, 2 nitrobutane, nitroethane or nitropropane as the mixture of product. So these reactions, they are not very useful in the case of alkane. Sulfonation can also be done. Sulfonation again can be done at very high temperature using oleum, a very strong acid, and this oleum can abstract the tertiary hydrogen with more ease or with more reactivity in comparison to primary or secondary hydrogen. So tertiary hydrogen is abstracted and this product is formed if you start from isobutane. So this is about the alkanes. We have finished the chemical property of a normal chemical property of alkane, but another important thing we can discuss is the pyrolysis. Pyrolysis, as we have done in the case of, as we have discussed previously also in previous lecture, the alkane can undergo catalytic cracking to form to convert the long chain alkane into short chain alkane. So that is known as pyrolysis. It is done in various industry the fractionating column can be used after the pyrolysis. We can use the fractionating column to collect different fractions at different points. So when an alkane is heated to a very high temperature without the presence of alkane can be converted into smaller alkenes because of disproportionation or hydrogen gas. Similar, you can see here methane can heated very high at the very high temperature, homolytic cleavage is taking place because there is no nucleophile or electrophile here, it is only the homolytic cleavage of bond which is taking place. So, it is forming methyl radical and hydrogen radical. So, these radicals, they are unstable, they decompose into carbon and hydrogen. Similarly, when ethane is heated, we are getting methyl radical unstable, it itself gets converted by disproportionation into ethene and methane. Normal propane can also undergo the cracking or pyrolysis and forming the neutral products. Now, butane can give you butene, propene, ethene, etc. So, pyrolysis generally giving you the mixture product. We have to pass this mixture product to a fractionating column in order to purify different fractions of alkane. So, this is all about alkanes. Now, next important topic in the case of organic chemistry is aromaticity. It is all, we all know that it is altogether different from alkanes. Alkanes, they are saturated hydrocarbons, but the aromatic compounds, they come under the category of these cyclic compounds containing multiple double bond, conjugated double bond, and they have certain important properties. These properties which are resembling with benzene. And these compounds which are having property like benzene, they are known as aromatic compound. Now, what are those properties which are differing this benzene from other unsaturated compounds? Benzene has got three double bonds, and it should undergo addition reaction because it has got double bond. Double bond generally undergo electrophilic addition reaction. But it was to surprise that benzene is not undergoing addition reaction, it is resisting addition reaction. And you can see if we are want to prepare a monosubstituted benzene, then monosubstituted benzene yield has only one product, although it has three bond, but it is giving only one product. But if we are forming a disubstituted benzene, we are getting a three isomeric product. And if you look at the heat of hydrogenation of benzene, if you compare the heat of hydrogenation of benzene with cyclohexatriene, this cyclohexatriene is similar to benzene containing three double bond. This is benzene and this is cyclohexatriene containing three double bond, benzene with a cycle. I have shown this by a cycle. Though when benzene is hydrogenated, it is giving only 49.8 kilocalories of energy, while cyclohexatriene on hydrogenation yields 85.8 kilocalories of energy. So, energy difference is of 36 kilocalories. So, this 36 kilocalories less energy is given out by benzene. That means benzene is more stable than cyclohexatriene. So, then you can also see the double bond length is only 1.35 angstrom, but in the case of benzene, it is only, the double bond length is not there. All the bond they are equal, and it is having a bond length of 1.39 angstrom. Then the structure of benzene was given by Kekulé as this. The structure of benzene is this third. It is neither one, nor two, because this structure, these one and two, they are representative of cyclohexatriene. This is not benzene. Benzene is actually a resonance hybrid of these two structures, and this is represented by the third one. So this is the structure of benzene, and this circle shows that there are six pi electrons which are delocalized over and above the plane of the ring. So these kind of compound was known as aromatic compound, and the compound which are having the property of benzene, they were called as aromatic compound by Huckel. And Huckel also studied the monocyclic system CnHn type and containing n pi electron, and he found that certain compounds are aromatic possessing the benzene like property. Now we can discuss one by one the cyclic system containing the pi bond, which are aromatic and which compounds out of them are aromatic and which are not aromatic in nature. So first, simplest system, the system should obey the Huckel rule. The first Huckel rule says that the compound should be cyclic and should have 4n plus 2 pi electron, then the compound becomes can behave like an aromatic system. Second point in the Huckel rule is all the carbon atoms should be sp2 hybridized and compound should be planar, and there should be a delocalization of this pi electron. The reason is not only the presence of pi electron, the pi electron should be delocalized above and below the plane of the ring, then this compound is known as aromatic compound. So you can see a few example here. Yeah, if it is one by one, the simplest cyclic compound is cyclopropene containing one pi bond. Now you can see here this compound has got 2 pi electron. This n can start from 0 because n can be an integer, so it is a 2 pi electron system. So first rule is obeyed here, but the second rule says that all the carbon atoms should be sp2 hybridized. So you can see this carbon is sp2, this is also sp2, but this carbon has got an sp3 hybridization. So the second rule is not obeying here, so that this compound is not an aromatic compound. So if you want to make this compound an aromatic compound, we should remove one electron. When we remove one electron from the system, it becomes a cyclopropenium cation. And cyclopropenium cation, how it becomes aromatic? Now first rule says that should have 4n plus 2 pi electron. Now you can see here there are 2 pi electron. Now all carbon should be sp2 hybridized. You can see all carbon, they are sp2 hybridized. Now the delocalization of third point is delocalization of the pi electron. So here you can see this pi electron, they are delocalized over all the carbon atom. This pi is going here, here and here. So all carbon, they are getting the positive charge, and there is almost system is delocalized. So this we can show this pi electron in a dashed circle. So this compound is an aromatic compound. So another example you can see here in the case of cyclobutadiene. Second cyclic system is cyclobutadiene. Cyclobutadiene has got, you can see 2 pi bonds. So 2 pi bond means 4 pi electron. 4 pi electron, that means it is not obeying the first rule of Huckel, that is it should have 4n plus 2 pi electron. Here it is having only 4 pi electron. That means this compound is not an aromatic compound, it becomes an anti-aromatic. If you want to make this compound an aromatic, we have to remove 2 electron from the system. Now this system has now becoming 2 pi electron system, and it is can show this system is having all the carbon sp2 hybridized, and this positive charge and the pi electron is delocalized over the ring. So this cyclobutadiene dication is an aromatic compound. Another important compound is cyclopentadiene. Cyclopentadiene has 4 pi electron. Now it is missing the part 2 of the rule, that is all carbon should be sp2 hybridized. This carbon is sp3 hybridized, so it is not an aromatic compound. But if you remove if you add 1 electron to the system, now the system has got 6 pi electron. All the 5 carbon plus 1 electron, 5 carbon with 5 p electron, so this become an aromatic compound. So next cyclic system is benzene having 6 carbon atom. So this is these are the few example of aromatic compound. So we have to look into the molecule, the number of carbon atom, and our carbon atom should be sp2 hybridized, and in the p orbital there should be a single electron, and the electron which are present in the p orbital, they are pi electron, and there should be 4n plus 2 pi electron should be present in the system in order to have the aromaticity. So that means the compounds is aromatic only if it is satisfying all the Huckel rule. So on the basis of these rule, we can also do other example. So this is all about the aromaticity and the chemical property of alkane. We will discuss the other topics in the next session. Thank you.
Dear friends, due to paucity of time, we have to stop our lecture here. On that note, we would like to thank Dr. Karna for coming to our show and delivering this wonderful lecture. And thank you, dear friends, for watching our lecture. Stay tuned and keep watching. Thank you.